Friends, good morning. Welcome to our Sunday service, 18th October 2020. Firstly, let me apologize for my cranky voice. I seem to be coming down with a bit of flu. Secondly, I would like to apologize for last Sunday. We do not know exactly what happened, but we seem to have lost the sound at the time the video was exported to our YouTube channel. Sadly, at the time the video was uploaded on YouTube, the original file was deleted, and as such, we could not be able to retrieve any of that work. Sincere apologies from our side as leadership together with the media team. With that said, may I invite us into a word of prayer. Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit, and guide and lead us. Accompany us as we offer ourselves to you. Holy Spirit, come and guide the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart. Come, Holy Spirit, and sanctify us. Come, Holy Spirit, and make us holy so that we may be able to offer praises and worship to God, our heavenly Creator. In the name of Christ, we bow before your holy throne, Holy Spirit. We say we are here, understanding and knowing fully well that during the course of the day and the week, we have transgressed and we have committed various sins in thought, in words, and in deed. But as we come into your holy presence, our God, we pray that you sanctify us and make us whole. Receive our worship, O God, that we make in the name of Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We pray for the Christian church, wherever it is meeting, in whatever form, shape, or size it is meeting. May you continue during this difficult season, our God, to empower us with the gift of your Spirit. And we pray this in the name of Christ and for his sake. Amen. And so, friends, we continue with the good news that is found in the Old Testament in the various scriptures of the prophets. And for our time together this Sunday, we now turn to what is known as minor prophets. And for this Sunday, we look at the book of Joel, chapter 2. The book of prophet Joel, chapter 2, we will read verses 18 to verse 27. It reads as follows. Then the Lord will be jealous for his land, and the Lord will take pity on his people. The Lord will reply to them, I am sending you grain, new wine, and new oil, enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. I will drive the northern army far from you, pushing it into a parched and barren land, with its front columns going into the eastern sea and those in the rear into the western sea. And its stench will go up, its smell will rise. Surely the Lord has done great things. Be not afraid, O land, be glad and rejoice. Surely the Lord has done great things. Be not afraid, O wild animals, for the open pastures are becoming green. The trees are bearing fruit. The fig tree and the vine yield their riches. Be glad, O people of Zion, rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the autumn rains in righteousness. He sends you abundant showers, both in autumn and spring rains, as before. The threshing floors will be filled with grain, and the vats will overflow with new wine and oil. I will repay you for the years the locust has eaten, the great locust and the young locust and other locusts, and the locust swarm, my great army that I send among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full, and you will praise the name of the Lord your God, who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be ashamed. they will know that I am in Israel and that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. And so, friends, we receive this as the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And so, friends, for our reflection this morning, just as a matter of trying to recap, in the first Sunday of the month of October, we started by looking at the story of the exiles as told by Jeremiah in the 29th chapter. A chapter or a letter that is written by Jeremiah to those Israelites who were taken away from their land into the land of the Babylonians. And Isaiah writes to them in exile, and he reminds and invites them to live again, to build houses, to plant new vineyards, to learn to live in an unfamiliar land, in a foreign land, to learn to make new memories despite the land being foreign to them. Last Sunday, in a message that unfortunately you did not receive, we then looked at the book of Isaiah chapter 49, another story, another letter, another prophecy for Israel that was sent to them while in exile, another exilic text. It is in that story of Isaiah 49 that there is a promise of God who says, I will gather my people from the east and the west, the north and the south, and I will send them back into the land of their forefathers. I will rebuild the temple so that they may be able to worship again. And today we turn our focus to the second chapter of the prophet Joel, as read between verses 18 to verses 27. The text in Joel has much similarities as that of prophet Jeremiah, as well as that of the prophet Isaiah. Inasmuch as there is no clear evidence that this, in the story of Joel, Israel is in exile, what seemed to be the case instead in the book of Joel is that Israel is in the land of Judah. But so many devastating elements have happened and incidents that have made this land to seem like a foreign land. In the first chapter, we hear the prophet introducing the subject and introducing the broader story, which now finds a response in the 18th verse of this second chapter. In the first chapter, what we find is a prophet who is lamenting together with the people of Israel. In fact, he's inviting Israel, the priest, those who wait at the altar, to weep, to fast and to pray, because Israel is attacked by a number of locusts that are eating the fiber of its community. The prophet Joel speak of this locust, or these different forms of locust that have eaten such that there is no crop anymore that is coming forth, that the ground, the land is able to bring forth anymore. The prophet laments and speaks of this locust that has destroyed almost the entire livestock of Israel. He speaks of a locust that has removed all forms of life in the land of Judah, in the land of the Israelites. There is no hope left. Instead, what seemed to be the end is death, destruction, and everything else associated with it. Israel now believes that the Lord has turned his back on them, and the future as such looks bleak. In the midst of this darkness that is covering the land of Judah, that is covering Israel, the prophet in the 18th verse of the second chapter, he then begins to allow the change in the narrative. From verse 1 From the first chapter to chapter 2, verse 17, the whole narrative, it is about what the people are saying, what the prophet is saying. There is no response, no word from God. But until the 18th chapter, when we now begin to hear the response from God, now the Lord speaks. And when the Lord speaks, he speaks a message of renewal. When the Lord speaks, he speaks a message of hope. When the Lord speaks, he speaks a message that the land will bring forth yet again the food from its soil. Through the prophet Joel, we hear the Lord saying to Israel, I am sending you grain. In other words, I am sending you food. In other words, your gallon of oil will never run empty anymore because of what the locusts have done. But instead, I will restore your empty barren of oil. I will restore your empty granaries. I am sending you new wine, says the Lord through the prophet Joel. And this new wine, it is a new wine that will taste nothing like the old wine. I am tempted to link the promise of the new wine to the story of Jesus at the wedding of Cana in Galilee. A Jesus who offers new wine because the old wine has an aftertaste, because the old wine is dependent on the activity of men, but the new wine is dependent much more on the grace, the unmerited favor of God that God gives to his people. So as the prophet speaks, he then speaks and says, I, the Lord, will drive away the enemies away from your land. I will drive them to the north, far away from you. In other words, the locust that is eating the fiber of this society, I will drive it away such that you as my people will never be shamed again. In fact, I will drive it into the eastern sea and I will drive it in the western sea, says the Lord. And here is a promise, not just of a renewal of God's people, but the entire creation will be restored and will be renewed. Be not afraid, O wild animals, for the open pastures are becoming green. Even the cattle will find greener pastures, because when the Lord restores, everything produces food, new wine, everything, the entire created order of God will be restored, because when the Lord restores, the Lord restores like no other. The trees are bearing their fruit. The fig tree and the vine yield their riches. Be glad, O people of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God. This is an invitation to join in the hymn and the song of thanksgiving. Here is a promise from God of Joel. He says, I will send you rain, not just rain, but enough rain for both the autumn and the springs as before, so that your threshing floors will be filled with grain. In other words, there will be no one who will go hungry. And in the promise of verse 25, I will repay for the years the locusts have eaten. The great locust, the young locust, and the other locust, and the locust swarm, my great army that I sent among you, says the Lord, I will restore. As a country, we have seen so many locusts that have come and eaten the fiber of our community. Not so long ago, we have been lamenting and witnessing in dismay and disbelief how the locusts have stolen from the poor in terms of the COVID-19 relief fund. how money has been stolen and the hungry and the poor have been pushed aside because the low caste has continued to dominate. And the Lord says, I will restore the years that the low caste, the corrupt low caste of our politicians, of our government that has eaten, I, the Lord, will restore the years that the low caste has eaten. In fact, even the young low caste, whatever little things that the young low caste has eaten, I will restore it. And we know that as a country we continue to struggle with the low caste of racism. We continue to struggle with the low caste that continues to create a kind of racial superiority of one class, of one group of people than the other. But here is a promise of God. I, the Lord, will restore all the years that these various locusts have eaten. And yes, even the locust called COVID-19, whatever it has eaten away from us, it has eaten our place of worship, it has eaten away our income, it has displaced us from a place that we call home, it has done all kinds of destruction. But here is the promise of God. In the midst of the season of darkness and doubt, there is the word from God, the word of hope. I will restore the years that the locust has eaten. And it is my prayer that we will hold true to these words of scripture, to God's word, to God's promise, that the years that the various locusts have eaten will be restored. And it is God who says, when I restore the years that the locust has eaten, never again will you be shamed as my people. Never again will you be driven away from a place you call home, because I, the Lord, has the power to restore the years that have been eaten by the various locusts. And it is my prayer that we hold true to these words, the simple words of scripture, that they become for us the life-giving inspiration that the Lord will restore the years that these various locusts have eaten. I know that we are all dealing with various kinds of locusts. Other locusts have eaten away our good health. Other locusts have eaten away our economical ability to buy milk, bread, and butter. Other various locusts have created a schism and difficulty in relationships as a church, as families, as communities. But all these locusts, whatever they have eaten, the Lord will restore them. But I don't want us to get an idea that these will be restored miraculously. The people in the story of Joel, in the community that Joel is talking to us about, they became co-workers with God to make sure that the years the locust has eaten becomes a thing of the past. They began to work towards a new land, a new future, a new community. Because our faith in God must never, never, not today, not tomorrow, not ever, take away our responsibility of being co-creators with God. May these words be enough for us as we continue to work alongside God, who restores the years that the locust has eaten. In the name of God, the Creator, Christ the Redeemer, Holy Spirit, the Comforter. Come, friends, let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for the promise of your word. We thank you for the message of hope, the message of restoration, the message of new birth. We believe your word. We believe you because your word and your promises are yes and your promises are amen. Restore our country. Restore our municipality. Restore our church. Restore our families. Restore the years that the locusts have eaten that have destroyed friendships. We offer ourselves to you, O God, as a living sacrifice. Accompany us with your grace. Accompany us with your love. We pray, O God, for those who have lost their loved ones. We pray for the sickly in our communities and around us. We pray for the hungry, the poor, the naked. We pray for our leaders. We pray, O God, in particular for our president, Cyril Ramaphosa. And we pray for the leaders of the church, that, O God, you will continue to give them wisdom that they may lead us in the path of righteousness. As you, O God, restore, as you, O God, make your way straight, help us in the name of Christ, that we may be co-creators with you, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you, friends. May the grace accompany you until we meet again in the next week. Now we share in the words of grace together. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, abide with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.